Please stand. In the waters of baptism, Maurice died with Christ. May he now rise with him to eternal life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome, everyone, as we've come together to pray for the repose of the soul of our brother Maurice, to offer our deepest sympathy, our comfort, our prayers to his wife, his family, and friends, but also to thank God for the blessings which he gave him in this life and those blessings which he brought to so many others. Welcome also to those who may be watching now or later on the streaming service as we come together with mixed emotions to pray for Maurice. Let's pray. Into your hands, O Lord, we humbly entrust our brother Maurice. In this life, you embraced him with your tender love. Deliver him now from every evil and bid him enter eternal rest. The old order has passed away. Welcome him then into paradise, where there will be no sorrow, no weeping nor pain, but the fullness of peace and joy with your Son and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading is from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
our second reading is from the second letter to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord. Please stand. With you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. The purpose of a funeral service is to pray for the departed, to offer comfort to his family and friends, but also to meditate on the meaning of life and death, looking in faith to the answers to the questions of what is life all about, and why do we lose those we love, and, of course, what next. Now, all of the scriptures are ultimately about each of these things, but I hope that these particular passages, in these particular passages, you can find some answers, but also see real reflection on Maurice's life. The vision of Apocalypse Revelation is universal, that hope of something more, the promise of something more, and not just something different, but something far, far better. A place where illness and death, sadness and suffering are no more, and verified by Christ himself, the Alpha and the Omega. However, we only get there through this world with its joys, its pleasures, but also with its sufferings, and illness and death are chief among those sufferings. But we are called, all of us, like Paul, to fight the good fight, to run the race, however hard, to the end, but always with the hope of what we saw in Revelation, and which Paul always kept in mind. Now, Jesus himself gives us the particulars in our final passage. The vision, the promise of a new home, a place with many rooms, many dwelling places, space for all of us, and he himself will go ahead to prepare a place for us. These all remind me of Maurice in reverse order. He understands the many dwelling places, of course, and had a particular gift of making places better, homes in England and Spain, small, unfurnished, made into wonderful places, but only by hard work and patience, and also the dwelling in the kingdom of heaven. And he knew very well how long the race could be and how difficult sometimes the fight was. But all in all, a good life, a happy marriage, but a life not without hard work, the long haul, with its own fights, and of course the last and greatest fight of age and illness. He and St. Paul will have much to talk about. But it all ends in that new heaven and that new earth. It doesn't make the loss any easier, but there may be a glimmer of hope that it is all true and that all is well, and be some comfort along with the many, many happy memories. A very good man, may he rest in peace. Amen. And I'd like to end with a little reflection, a prayer that Maurice and Maureen knew well. God, be in my head and in my understanding. God, be in mine eyes and in my looking. God, be in my mouth and in my speaking. God, be in my heart and in my thinking. God, be mine and at my departing. Amen. And now please stand and join in singing Jerusalem. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his. And the response to each petition should be, hear our prayer. In baptism, Maurice received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our brother was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Many friends and members of our family have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy. Morris's family and friends seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness that comes from grief. Lord, in your mercy. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Maurice. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. Lord, in your mercy. And in a moment of silence, we offer our personal prayers to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we join all of our prayers together as we pray in the words our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of our Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now please be seated for some personal tributes.
Maureen's Memories of Maurice. Maurice was the fourth son of Nora and Henry Willis, born in West Street in Burgess Hill after his brother Sonny. Big surprise to his mum that he was on the way. When he was born, his mother said, "Poor little devil, he didn't ask to be born because he was so tiny." His brothers would take him for a walk in his pram, and they often clung onto the side of the pram to get a ride. One day the pram was running fast and got out of control, and the pram tipped up, throwing baby Maurice out. Needless to say, his mum wasn't very happy with the boys, but Maurice was all right and probably thought it was fun. Maurice was born to a poor family, but Maurice got himself a paper round as soon as he was old enough and started earning money to buy himself clothes. He went on to get a wooden coke round, where he would go to the wooden coke sites to black the spare wood and coke to sell to neighbours, trundling it on a truck on wheels that he had built. Maurice loved the cinema, but he was too young to go on his own, so he would wait outside the cinema with his friend Jeff Wickens until his brother Sonny and then girlfriend Irene came along and they would take him in. Maurice often paid for this and his trips to the swimming pool by going to the dump and collecting lemonade bottles to take back to the shop and get sixpence for each bottle. He was always very enterprising, even at an early age. When Maurice left school, he managed to get himself on an engineering apprenticeship at a local factory called Tyler's. He worked in the factory, learning his trade, where, amongst other things, he learned to sharpen drills, something he was proud of. Later, he was assigned to work at the foundry at New Haven for a few weeks. He loved it, working by the sea. He had never seen the sea up to that point. The foundry blokes asked that he be allowed to work there for a few more weeks because he proved to be a big asset to them. Maurice had a natural ability for anything, and soon he was put in the electrical department building and testing meters. He got to wear a white coat, something, again, he was very proud of. When he walked through the factory in his white coat, all the blokes wolf whistled. Later in his career, he was put in charge of the experimental department, building and testing gas boilers. He often went up to the Gas Council in London to liaise with the Gas Council engineers if there was a particular problem with a boiler that they were testing. Maurice was very highly thought of up there. Talking to the gas engineers from the Gas Council, who often came to the factory in Burgess Hill, Maurice found that they were earning a lot more money than him, and this unsettled him. So much so that one day, Maurice called Maureen at her place of work and told her that he was thinking of working for himself, installing heating systems, and asked what did she think. There was no hesitation, and Maureen said, yes, absolutely, knowing that Maurice would never take on anything he thought he couldn't do. And so he embarked on a career working for himself for 40 years, only retiring at 70. Retiring mainly because gas exams had to now be taken every 5 years, and he was fed up with taking these, even though he was more than able to complete them. But like most of Maurice's generation, he found it stressful. When Maurice was 17 and Maureen 15, they both went to a weightlifting show with brother John and his wife Anne, Maureen's sister. It was there that Maurice asked Maureen out. Maureen had previously seen Maurice at school, and she liked what she saw. So she was rather pleased. And so Maurice and Maureen started out on their journey. Straight away, they started saving to buy a house together. Maurice earning extra money, working as a bouncer at such places as the Downs Hotel in Hassocks and the Pilgrim Pub in Hayward's Heath. Maurice and Maureen were married in this church in 1968. After saving up sufficient funds, they bought their first house in Knoll Rise, Burgess Hill. I can share a personal memory of their Knoll Rise home, visiting as a young boy with my dad, Bill, who Maurice often referred to as Dizzy. Maurice definitely liked the best things in life. I remember my dad being envious of Maurice's cutting-edge stereo or TV. Maurice and Maureen had holidays in Spain since 1966, when they could afford it. And when Maurice started working for himself, they found they had more money for holidays and cars, and soon they had enough money saved to buy a bigger house. Maurice's philosophy was, don't spend more than you earn. He always said that earning money was easy. It was learning how to spend it that was the hard bit. They found out that there was a cottage in James Lane coming up for sale. It took them a year to buy the house. Maurice actually hated James Lane before living there, because when he was a boy, his mum would send him from West Street up James Lane and into the retreat at the end to beg for a few shillings from the nuns. Maurice's mum Nora worked at the retreat when she came over from Ireland as a young girl, and she would write them a note asking for money, and Maurice would hand over the note and then take the 5 shillings back to his mum. They were hard times. Buying the house in James Lane was like a dream come true. A house with its own driveway and a big garden. For the next 7 years, they set about extending the house, building it in the farmhouse style. Maurice wheeling and dealing for a good price for bricks, tiles, windows and doors, etc. And during this time, they lived with Maureen's mum in her 2-bed flat just around the corner. Every spare minute after work and weekends was spent at the house, Maureen helping Maurice with painting, sawing floorboards, and anything else she could do to help him. When they had the time and spare money, they would holiday in Spain, starting in hotels and then moving up to renting other people's villas. One day, when they were heading for 60 years of age, in their kitchen, Maurice said to Maureen, is this it then? We have a lovely house, but what now? Are we just going to tread water to the cemetery? And it was then that they decided to look for a villa in Spain, going on inspection trips to find what they were looking for. It took a few years, eventually finding a plot of land with plans in place for a villa. It was a big decision to make, to spend a lot of money on a villa in Spain. It was while they were on a coach trip in the gardens of Heligan and the Eden Project, after an evening of drinks, Maurice said to Maureen, I think we'll buy that villa. To which Maureen said, "Well, let's talk about it in the morning when you were sober." In the morning, and whilst together with their friends, Sally and Terry Bannister, who were on the same trip, Maurice decided to buy their villa in Spain. For the next 2 years, the villa was built, and Maurice and Maureen holidayed there every 4 or 5 weeks. At the time of the decision to buy the villa, standing in their kitchen again, Maurice said to Maureen, "If we buy this villa, we will have 2 lives, one here and one in Spain." And that is what happened. The two of them felt so much younger in the sun, and they spent as much time in Spain as they could. Maurice and Maureen also started learning Spanish when they bought the villa, which was not easy when you're over 60. Now, 20 years later, the villa is a mature and lovely house, much loved. Maurice loved it there, always painting the walls and the balustrades and pruning the now huge palm trees. "You are always up a ladder when I see you," remarked her neighbour Mike. Maurice was a very talented man, a perfectionist. He could do just about anything and didn't need to call on tradesmen to do the work. No one knows except Maureen what a lovely singing voice he had, only finding this voice in later years. In his youth, he found that he could write words for songs, and he teamed up with a friend, Mickey Clark, who could play the piano and guitar. Sadly, Mickey went on his own way and they lost touch. But for the last few years, Maurice wrote the lyrics for 30 songs and he was aiming for 40. Maurice and Maureen were together for more than 60 years, a lifetime of love and laughter and always working together as a team. Maurice had a wicked sense of humour, and the relationship really worked. And they had a full and rewarding life together. Maurice did all that he wanted in his life. He didn't want to be poor, as his parents were, and he wanted a nice house and nice cars, all of which he achieved and more. A life well lived, some would say. Rest in peace, my darling, until we meet again.
"Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard him call. I turned my back and left it all."
"I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work, to play. Tasks undone must stay that way. I found that peace at close of day."
"If parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Oh yes, these things I too will miss."
"Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full, I savoured much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch."
"Perhaps my time seemed all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your hearts and share with me. God wants me now, he set me free."
Maureen and Maurice's neighbour in Spain, Mike, is meant to be here giving memories, but he's clearly been out in Spain too long. He thought he could fly into Gatwick late this morning and get here in time, and of course hasn't, but we hope he makes it a little bit later and can share some of those memories just in person. Let us pray. Trusting in God, we've prayed together for Maurice, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see him again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Maurice, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant Maurice, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, till we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Requiem aeternam, dona ei Domine et lux perpetua luceat ei. qui quiescat in pace. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. And may his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. And may the love of God and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ console you, and gently wipe every tear from your eyes. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us take our brother to his place of rest.